Not taking the opportunity there with them because they did not have a daycare provider option within our community. And so for the betterment of us, she wanted to do that. Brittany Reed, she is also another mom on the board here who would just like to see, make sure there's options for other families as well as curriculum, because she too had a three-year-old. Kayla Holtz, she just recently joined our board a couple months ago. She's the principal at the elementary school. Connecting pieces, just because she is at the school, it gives a different background for us to connect with her. And then also, she has been around kiddos for most of her life. While she doesn't have her own, she's definitely familiar with what it's like to be with them.
Alright, so we're going to take a virtual tour of the center. So as you know, we're located in the elementary. We have a buzz-in system, so the door is always locked. We can see you and talk to you both. Kind of show a little picture up there while we see who's out there. We have three rooms down this hallway. The first one will be our toddler room, which is now a currently two-year-old room that we're working out of. Has its own exit, and each room has its own sink. back in the corner. And as we exit the, you see the bathrooms across from my office, that's what the preschool age room will be using as those bathrooms right there. Okay, what we offer at Sumner Daycare Learning Center, like we mentioned, starting February 27th, we will actually start taking infants. That is something new. Originally, we were taking 2 to 12, so we are definitely excited about it. Also, we're not just a daycare, we are a learning center. We have creative curriculum, which also the school follows. So it's kind of just getting them prepared to go right into the preschool or in the kindergarten or whatever parents desire. We're going to have parent-teacher conferences twice a year, once in the fall, once in the spring. Kind of touch base of where we were kids doing at the time. We do ages and stages, which is where they're supposed to be developmentally, and just kind of touch base of where they're at, if they're exceeding on level or maybe we have a little bit of concern. We do have access with AEA to partner with us if parents need more help or extra help getting your child where it needs to go, where it needs to be. Also, starting February 27th, we will have a new rate option, which will be on the next slide that I'll talk to. We will care for 6 weeks to 12 years. So that's through 12 years until they turn actually 13. So that we've had that question, is it right at 12? It'll be through until they actually turn 13 on their birthday. With our new rates, we have for discounted rates for siblings, if you come 5 days and the second kid comes 5 days, you get $25 discount. So trying to help families that have more kiddos. We don't want to nickel and dime you, but we do know child care is expensive, so trying to help you guys out. The more you come, the less you pay per hour throughout the week. Trying to help you there too. And the app we used is Brightwheel. It's what we use to clock in, clock out, teacher schedules, staff schedules. And the best feature that I love about it is we get to communicate with the parents throughout the day. So each teacher has access to the app, and say your child had a great craft, they can take a picture and send it to you. And only you see the Facebook and everything. So it's also a way where if you have questions, or you can either email me or message me personally or them. A lot of the times they'll say they have a late start. Is your kid coming in at the time they're scheduled or coming later? It's a great way, quick way to let everybody know at once. And these are our new rates. So we offer 5 day, 4 day, 3 day, 2 day, 1 day, and a half day. We decided to go with half days because we have the preschool program. And they only go half days, and we wanted to get those kiddos coming before and after. And then our school age ones, we do by groups of hours. And then I will turn it over to Alexis.
So as Miranda mentioned, the infant room will be open February 27th. As I said earlier, I will be switching from an assistant teacher to the teacher in that room. I do also have 2 forms of what the curriculum might look like, kind of thing, for the week. We follow gauge as rules and regulations, making sure they're on their back We encourage moms to breastfeed their infants. We will have a fridge that was located in Miranda's room that will switch over into the infant room, so any breast milk that needs to be stored, there's also a freezer that's attached to the fridge, so either way, you would be fine with that. And I can't wait for the infants to start.
So currently we are in the 2-year-old room, everyone is, as you saw in the video, and that will be our toddler room once we split off into the infant room and the preschool age room. So this is kind of a little snippet of what our day looks like. Thank you. Same as with their carrots?
No, yes, you do. You have carrots. How about you, Grover?
One thing I didn't get a video of was breakfast. That starts around 7 a.m. And then we have some sensory time with Play-Doh. Then around 9:15 we have snack. And then circle time is when you saw Miss Lydia sitting there reading a story. So we actually have made a few changes since the video even. We have their names, all the kiddos have their own rug, and they have their name on the rug. So now they're doing a much better job of sitting. I know you've noticed a couple more like laying down. And so we made that change, and it's really improved quite a bit. They sit on their bottoms during the story and sit quietly. So that's going really well. And we also discussed, I think it's on the next slide. Is it? Okay. And then after that, we have song time, and they love picking up songs. Baby Shark, of course, is a favorite. And Lion Hunt, they love that one. Then we do some crafts, play outside. We try to make sure to get outside every day unless the temperature is too cold, of course. Then we do centers, then lunch, brush our teeth, take our nap, and then nap time is usually around 1 o'clock for a few hours. And then around 3, we have some kiddos come in from school, the school-age kiddos come in. And we have snack time at 3:15. And that's most of our day. So that's the typical time. And then we read a story, and we'll also discuss the calendar, what day it is, what month it is. We have a healthy day, so they get to help out with the craft. They can hand out things to the craft, or they can be the line leader when we go outside, things like that. So they love to, you know, who's going to be the helper today? They're all excited about that.
How do you choose?
We have a little chart on the back.
We need a chart. Like, why don't we help
on
here today?
Okay.
We just
were
yesterday.
So we just know what date around the room. That's when you saw Grover with the little buttons, and he had like a plastic sheet. He was writing the numbers, and he would trace the number, and then he would put the amount of buttons on those little dots on his paper. So that was one station. Then the other station we had was puzzles, at the table, and then the other station we had was reading books, or vice versa, reading books was one of them. And then we'll set a timer, and for usually about 5 minutes, and they each sit at their station for 5 minutes, and then when it beeps, they rotate to a different station. So then it gives the teachers more one-on-one time with the kiddos to work on writing their name or tracing their numbers or things a little bit trickier or more complex or like using scissors, things like that. So that's center time. It's great for hand-eye coordination and those fine motor skills, holding their writing utensils correctly. A lot of them just want to, you know, hold it like this and scribble. So working on that. And it also helps working independently, you know, putting those puzzles away when they're done, or putting the little lid back on their marker, things like that. So, and I'll let Alexis tell you about our food program.
So you follow a CACFP, which stands for Child and Adult Care Food Program. So I'm there during pretty much breakfast, lunch, AM snack, and then we also have incorporated PM snack. It was just in the beginning, breakfast, lunch, and PM snack. So now the kids get fed every 3 hours. Most of the breakfast is brought down to us unless it is a no school day. Then we take the kids and we say, we're going on a field trip, then we'll go grab breakfast in the cafeteria. They will sit at the table and all eat together, and then a little bit later they eat lunch, and the cart either gets brought down to us or we will, one of us, depending on who's in the room, will go grab it if the kitchen is super busy that day. The lunch menu does get rotated, and they pretty much eat what the school age kids do eat, and then we serve it kind of like family style. It all gets brought in bowls, and then we portion out what they're supposed to get, and we follow by a sheet, which is CACFP. And then for AM snack, the same thing. That one we go grab, it's in a cooler, and we portion that out too. And then PM snack, we grab from Miss Miranda's office, and the kids get some extra little snacks at the end of the day, depending on what time they're here until.
So I added in a few pictures of some of the crafts we've done. This little piggy was a puppet that we made with a lunch bag. And so for that one and the polar bear, they had to rip little pieces of tissue paper. So again, working on those fine motor skills. And then they glued them on. And then you can see Sophie's holding a little moose that we made with a puppet too. And then for the sheep on the far right, they used a clothespin and dipped it in paint. So, just some ideas of things that we do for craft time. Coming this week, starting on Tuesday, we're gonna have every Tuesday and Thursday, the fourth graders will come down to our room, and they're gonna buddy up with a kiddo from our room and read to them. So, yeah, it's gonna be a fun partnership, and I'm really looking forward to that. So that's a new thing we're starting. Also, we have River County Conservation coming once a month. Let's see, this one, one of the ones we've done is animal tracks. So the lady's name is Heather. Up there you can see she's reading them the book. She brings all her supplies with her. And so she reads them a story, and then she talks about whatever topic it is for that day. And then she usually brings a craft, and sometimes she'll have an activity. Like one of the days was about polar bears and penguins, and so she brought a big mitten that would be like as if you had the blubber of a polar bear. And so they got to put the mitten on and put their hand in the snow and feel like, oh, it's really not cold because I've got this big blubber, you know, mitten on. So it kind of is a, you know, kid's perspective of explaining. They do a great job. And then this one, she's doing stamps. She brought stamps of the animal tracks. So like what a rabbit track looks like and what a deer track looks like, and they got to stamp on their paper what those were. And then we also partner with the Sumner Public Library here, and we use books from the library for our regular morning story time. And they've been great to help us out with that. So we appreciate that.
and just preparing your kiddos for the next stage. So the teachers and staff here are confident that we can shape and mold and prepare these kiddos for the next stage of their development. Whether it's preschool, kindergarten, or just learning to be more independent, we've all made it our mission to develop the skills they need for that next stage. And as Miranda said earlier, we use creative curriculum, which is the same as the Sumner Fredericksburg School District uses here. So just making sure we include, you know, letters, numbers, colors, shapes, and those things. And then she also mentioned we'll be doing parent-teacher conferences in the spring and fall to keep the parents updated on that progress. So I'll hand it over to Lydia.
As I said before, in my background is more in experiential learning, hands-on stuff. So it will look a little bit different from the young ones. Because at this point, they have developed their egos and they know what they like. So we have kids that like dinosaurs. We like kids that like the cars. So we want to make sure the room will probably look a little bit more full because two-year-olds like to dump. And so we keep that down a little bit and by keeping the count of toys a little bit lower, where the four-year-old room is going to have, we're going to have definitive centers in it where they'll be able to practice their handwriting. They'll have a science area. They'll have the housekeeping area, all those areas. And so our center time is usually making sure that those kids who only like the blocks move around the room and do get the experiences of the whole room still, so that they are learning everything that they need to and know that there are other options. And we try and keep, like I said, the child approach is trying to incorporate everybody's interests into what we're learning. And so in my background also, I my most recent certification was in outdoor learning. So in my classroom, I'm hoping, especially with the summer and when spring comes around, we're gonna do a lot more outdoor time. And I'm gonna try and get them outdoors a lot more and incorporate that for them, especially since we are here in Iowa and we have a lot of farmers that are, you know, work outside all day and things like that. So realizing that that's part of the community is important. And so, and my classrooms tend to be a little bit more, I like baskets and wood toys and things like that that are more, how do I put it? Just not the plastic. We try to cut down on that a little bit and make it more of a natural environment for them. And their learning will definitely be expanded upon and prepping them to be prepared to go on to kindergarten. So there'll be a lot more math being attended to and literacy part. There'll be a very language-rich type classroom where there are labels and how they can make that connection with what their languages are, what the languages and what it looks like for them. Also, our classroom, because children are so egocentric, we'll have like more mindfulness time where we reflect. They'll have journals and things like that that they will be able to work on. I tend to leave things a little bit open-ended, but sometimes they will be focused on a particular item. Also, I'm leaning towards, if it works with them, we'll have a helper of the week rather than the day, where that will incorporate where they get to share a lot about themselves as well as helping others and things like that. But that's basically how we do it, so that everybody feels important in the classroom all the time.
She likes to recycle and reuse stuff.
Yes, I do. I'm always to use just about anything. For sure. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about summer ideas. Since we're limited, we don't have transportation. So we're trying to make the summer fun, not only for the kids that go to the daycare themselves, but also for the kids that are school age kids that won't be in school. So some of the ideas were, obviously, this is the library. We're close enough where we can walk. Water days at the center, which would be like sprinklers, water sponges, that kind of stuff. touring local businesses. If we can walk to them, we've had like the post office is a good one, visiting the grocery store. Stocking shelves, stuff like that. Any of the business on Main Street, if we can possibly go into, what is it? I'm not from here, so the business out here, Lifeline, taking a tour, just trying to get those communities that balance is they kids know what's going on in the fire station. Doing a bike rodeo. That's always a fun one where you bring your bikes in and do an obstacle course. Food prep. This is something I like to do one a day a week type thing where they learn how to do basic measuring, mixing drinks like punch or squeezing lemons out, stuff like that, just to get them the sense of actually being able to prepare food. STEM projects through the Iowa State University. They usually have STEM packages for the school age kids and keep their learning going. Guest speakers to actually come into the center. So again, we can have the fire trucks, police officers, authors. We guys have a program for librarians to come in to talk, continue with the Bremer County extension coming in. So getting anybody into that's in the community come in to talk to us. I'd like to also have each week someone come in and talk about their career. So dentists, doctors, nurses, lawyers, recycling people. So that way the kids can get a different variety of what jobs are out there, what people do. And then the outside games and activities. Now I want to pose to you guys, since I'm not here, what do you guys think would be also something that we could do to bring in with the lack of not having transportation that we have to walk to or bring into the center?
So I know some of the communities around incorporate walk that actually, they don't go to any one particular place, but they go to little spots where businesses or houses have posted like big painted a rock and posted it outside. Or like, kind of like an Easter egg hunt.
Okay.
And then they've done story walks where they post like a page of a book and then they follow the book page by page around a few blocks. And I thought it doesn't even have to be, you know, very far. It could be just one block around the neighborhood.
Perfect. I love that.
There's like that group called Sumner Rocks. They paint rocks. Mm-hmm. They hide them.
The Sumner Kindness Rocks, there's that. You could maybe organize, like have a specific day where parents would come and maybe drop off kids maybe at the park and do the story walk, like you said. I know Parks
can't
and
drop
Rec.
Off at the park. They have to drop off at the
They do, okay.
DHS requirements.
Gotcha. But yeah, like even that, or walk down here to the park and then do like a little story walk or kindness walk. Because I know it's kind of hard to get down to City Park from where you're at, but this would be a little closer.
You could do like a bird watching walk. I know you guys have a lot of different birds out here I've never seen before in the West Coast.
It's funny. You don't really like all of that. Yeah, right. Yes, love that. Anything else? I'm from Waverly, so I don't know over here very well. So there's like tons of different stuff over there, but without transportation, it just kind of
I know. I think our goal
is outside a box
to make the summer program more of a summer camp, so it's not a
routine. Learning, but make them that they want to come instead of not want to come.
Right.
So maybe even like
Thank you for those ideas. I love it.
Staff has been friendly, helpful, and caring. The routine and structure SDLC provides for my son prior to him beginning preschool this coming fall is unmatched, and I feel confident sending him there daily and can feel assured that he is safe and extremely well cared for. We both love SDLC and highly recommend it. And that was from a mother named Shelby. When we found out Sumner was going to have a center in the school, we were overjoyed. Our first day, I knew we'd made the right decision to attend. The teachers and student teachers were so kind and attentive. It's easy to leave your kiddo every day when you know they are safe and in a fun and loving environment. Grover talks fondly of all his friends and his teachers at daycare. We're so grateful to have a center right in town, and I really appreciate everyone who has made it possible. And that's from a mom named Kelly. Sumner Daycare and Learning Center has been such a great addition to our child's life. At first, we were a bit nervous with how she would respond to a new structured environment with many new faces, a different routine, and a new setting altogether. Those nerves quickly went away within the first week of her attending the center. She comes home each day with new songs, new crafts, and new stories about her day. And we couldn't be more proud of her or this excellent center that is really making an impact on our community. Our daughter adapted quickly, which is great for her, but also a huge reflection on the type of care and commitment the teachers and staff at Sumner Daycare and Learning Center have for their children and their care. Aside from offering quality child care, the center communicates directly with parents and caregivers through an app. I love this, as staff are quick to send photos and messages through the app to keep us updated on our daughter's day, or send us important information regarding center updates. I love being able to ask about her specific parts of her day and watch her light up as she tells us all about her latest creation or experience. Making the switch to the center wasn't a decision we made lightly. Change can be scary, especially when that change directly impacts the life of your child. The big draw for us was the clear structure, open communication, and ability to have multiple staff caring for our baby. Although we are paying a bit more now, investing in our child's education and quality childcare was the best thing we could have done for our daughter and our family. The teachers and staff at Sumner Daycare and Learning Center are amazing. They have been nothing but patient, kind, and understanding in our experience thus far. We are incredibly lucky to have them in our community, and I truly hope this center becomes a staple in our community for years to come. Our children deserve the best quality child care, and they get all that and more at Sumner Daycare and Learning Center.
All right, so kind of to give you an idea of where it started. So we started with like a community meeting back in June of 2021. And so that was brought because they did a survey in February of that year, finding that for a lot of families in our community needing daycare, as well as before and after school, and the preschool was no longer going to be there. So we wanted to have an opportunity to do something. We were looking around, planning on building a building, but unfortunately didn't find anything that fit our needs at the time. And then that was when the school presented itself that we could potentially go in there since they had extra classrooms. So that's what we were doing. And then at that point, we were just doing 2 through 12 year olds. There was, as I said, DHS licensing. You gotta love all of the regulations and everything, which definitely there's a need for because we want our kids to be safe and in the best environment. And just recently found that we are able to be there. So right now we are licensed until June of 2024. And then after that, we will have to figure out what the potential, maybe new building, or what opportunity will be able to present itself at that point. So we're just anxious of what we can do right now and what this looks like. And they're doing a phenomenal job, a lot of great feedback. And it's all because of you guys as the staff, not because of the board. The board is the outside, and they do their thing. That is theirs to handle. So right now, we started the nonprofit as just really parents. We started with nothing, no money, no nothing. Not even the knowledge behind us of what we were doing. So we have been very, very grateful for all of the grant opportunities that we've had and being able to finance it. We've also had some community members as well as the city reach out and be able to fund us so that we are able to operate. We're still going to have to continue to focus on that, as obviously daycare is not a money-making business at all, but it's definitely an essential thing that we need to have in our community to keep it growing and maintain where we are at. I guess our biggest thing that when we started this was it was sad to hear one of the local realtors just kept reiterating that people weren't moving to our community because there's no daycare. And like I said, hospital, other businesses within our community,
they just weren't taking those opportunities because they had no one for the kids. And it's important to have our younger generation as well as our older to be able to make sure that there's a future for our community. And so with that, it actually progressed to people were leaving our community because of the daycare situation. And so we really knew we needed to focus on something in the meantime to get going rather than waiting for a building to be built and move on. And as far as our future plans, so we're super, super excited because we can start this infant phase right now. I guess kind of a background too of why we wanted to start where we were at. We knew we were going to start small. There's business part of having a daycare as well as the classrooms and all of that. Anywhere you go, there's staffing concerns and things. And we wanted to make sure we have the right fit. We didn't want to just hire people to be in our classroom. We wanted to make sure we had the right staff in our classroom. Because the kiddos are so important. It's you're going to your day job and they're ending up spending more time with your kids than you are. And you want to make sure it's the right fit. And we definitely have that with our staff here. They really have a lot of passion that they're bringing into the classroom. And if you ever have an opportunity to go and see the kids actually in action with them, it's very obvious that they really enjoy each and every one of them. So we're very fortunate. So we're excited. It's going to be kind of a work in progress of what it looks like. We're definitely needing a lot of input from community as well as our staff of what the direction truly is. But we also know we need to start looking at that sooner rather than later. So that is one part of it.
So, end of the actual presentation. So we actually prepared a craft for craft time. So you're welcome to enjoy that. Or she could like explain it to you. Otherwise, we will take questions.
So what do you guys do?
We take child care assistance for the state. I know. The actual state is actually trying to raise that up to help more parents. It just got proposed to the state. I don't know when they're going to vote on it or how that progresses, but that letter came out, was it Monday or Tuesday, I believe.
Yeah.
So I think right now it's at 145 and they percent of poverty, and they want to raise it up to 155. So we accept that, and then the parent just pays the difference between whatever they don't pay. Okay. And we give you that information at actual registration, too.
With the three classrooms, when they're fully functional on the 27th, what is your capacity?
We can technically have 125 kids in the staff, or in the center. We also have a cafeteria for before and after school if we end up needing it.
Okay.
We will not be taking 125 kids. Because that would be 21 kids in the infant room. We're not going to go that. So we're debating about how much we want to go in there, but the bigger room will be either kept, or either room will be kept off between 12 and 16 max, and then probably the same with the toddler room. Lydia's room, the older room, might be a little bit more, but we will not max out the rooms. That'd be too many kids in those rooms. We stay with the ratios what the state originally did for child care. So infants is considered any kid under 2.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a 1-to-4 ratio. 2-year-olds is 1-to-6. The state actually will allow us to do 1-to-7, but we're staying with the 1-to-6. The 3-year-olds, the ratio we're going to stick with was 1-to-8. The state says we can do 1-to-10. We think that's way too many 3-year-olds. So, and then the state ratio for 4-year-olds is 1-to-12. So, those are the ones we have to follow. We want us to keep the minimum ones just because we want to have the better care, not to cram kids in the center.
So I assume you'll have a wait list in place.
Eventually, yes. We're talking about how we're going to handle that once we get to that point. Right now, like I said, we're just starting to ramp up. We do have a lot of open space. I feel the infant room is going to be the one that fills up the fastest. That will be the first one we have a wait list. just because that's where the need is. The majority is the infants, the toddlers. Usually grandparents like to watch the older kids, not the younger kids, I've noticed. So, that's exciting that we're able to start off with that.
So for like outdoor time, are you guys able to do like recess with the elementary kids?
We do not do it with them. We do it in between.
Okay.
So we actually use the 4-year-old playground.
Okay.
So we know when they go out, and they only go have class Monday, Wednesday, Fridays. So Tuesday, Thursdays, we have the playground to ourselves. And we just have to Monday, Wednesday, Fridays to make sure that whenever they're out there, we're not out there, but we have them any other time. And then no school days. For the older kids, we can use a school playground. We just can't use parts of it because it's not considered safe for our regulations.
We have more stringent regulations in the school. It's kind of crazy that they can be the same, but...
Yeah, same kids play on the same playground, but we can't, they can, yeah. That's the difference between Department of Ed and Human Services. So, two different regulations.
So you guys are a nonprofit, you do go to the hospital as well. Are you guys doing like events for donations? Or?
We will be. So right now, when the board decided we were not going to go to the community with this phase of it, knowing that we probably have to do a building or something later on. We want to make sure we're cognizant of what they are contributing at this point. So right now we had it, but we do plan to do fundraisers in the future.
Okay. So at this point, if I may ask, what is it that your center is needing or may be needing in the near future?
I know we're compiling a list of what we kind of want and need. It's like mainly supplies, the stuff that we incur with the infant room, trying to get that stuff brought up. The stuff that's minimal but necessary. That kind of stuff, craft stuff, the infant room, like burp rags. Because they use them a lot. But it's one of those things that, baby toys, gently used or new, because again, it's a brand new situation. That's, we're trying to keep our funds, so just kind of, we're relying on a lot of the board members to bring a lot of the stuff in, because like she said, we don't want to ask the community. Mm-hmm. So it's just kind of finding that stuff. What are the things you would...
Rugs.
I would prefer, and that helps me section off centers and things like that. I would say for like when we start getting close to summer, thing outdoor items, because we're very limited right now. So things like cones are great. I mean, especially with a bike radio. If the city is getting rid of any cones that they're not using anymore, we would love to be able to have.
But she likes to recycle stuff.
I would love a rope so that we can walk a little easier, that we can tie little circles into and they can hold onto. Because right now we're holding hands, but and have a couple of kids that are really good at holding hands with each other, but over time, and not everybody's going to be great at that, so having some of those little tools that we can make stuff ourselves out of helpful. Tubs for water, things like that, that maybe were used, but you don't need anymore.
And when parents come in with their infants or, you know, even older children, do you have
just for like anything that they, when they bring their child in, anything that they need on the baby,
The stuff that's provided, it'll be our handbook, and then it's individually, we talk with the parents about what they're providing and what we're providing.
Okay.
A lot of the stuff we provide, the infants, we have a little different, because diapers, diapers, wipes, that kind of stuff is very individualized, where once they get up to the toddler stage, we don't need parents to bring in their own toilet paper.
Like water bottles and blankets, extra sets of clothes. Those are the basics that we ask for, that for the parents to supply. And then, of course, we always have extras for diaper needs and things like that.
How do you guys feel about reusable diapers, like cloth diapers?
No, we have no way to wash them. We have no way to sanitize them. So
true.
We have to use DHS has cloth, or it has to be the disposable diapers. Unless the only stipulation is if a doctor says they actually have to have it because of allergies or something like that, then we have to accommodate.
I'm sure they make like hypoallergenic diapers.
There is a stipulation saying in there if they're completely allergic or something, but
I just want shark tape actually. I brought there that was completely natural. So. Of course. Yeah.
Any questions?
I was curious. You had mentioned things about like labeling and just kind of like labeling toys and things like that. I'm not sure if there are any kids who are like blind or deaf, but have you thought about labeling in Braille, or do you have anybody who's sign language?
I know.
One of our high schoolers does a lot of sign language. So it's something that we haven't run into. But if it does, we, like I said, we have the AEA that they're there to help us with kids that have disabilities, whether it's hearing, sight, developmental disabilities, whereas that before we had a kiddo that had a whole bunch of different medical things, brain, back, all that stuff, so he couldn't walk. So usually in a daycare, you can't use those little, what they call burpees or whatever, bundles that they can't, for sitting up, we can't use those. But since the AEA come in and says he has to have it, because that's the only way he can set up, the doctor writes it, they can have that. They also, if the parents will allow it, they come into the center and actually work with them with physical therapy with them, so that the teachers know how to continue that work with them. So that AEA support is a great one when it's out of our expertise of REL type of thing.
And I know Ashley has background in special needs. I'm not sure honestly how much you have. Over the years, I've had children with very minor special needs, very extreme special needs stuff. And I worked in a day treatment that was more with older children, so that were removed from their school systems, and so we acted as a school program for them. So but we do have some diversity but everything's different. So we're never prepared, but you find out what you have and what resources they have. That's always a big key, is using, making sure you have that connection. Whatever resources that family has set up for them through the state. Yeah.
And we have partners with the parents. So if the parents want something, we have access to reach out. So we have, like I said, AEA, CCRNR, DHS. We have all the different organizations that the parent knows that their child needs a certain type of help, we're there to help them. Sometimes we can fast pace that sometimes further than a parent can by themselves. So we have those connections, and they know that we have the teachers that have the background to say, okay, yes, this kid needs the help, versus the parent saying, I think my kid needs it, but I'm not sure. So we have those resources.
And I know I was late getting this recorded, but if everybody would just kind of introduce themselves real quick, that way everybody else that wants to see the video can know who each of you are. Okay. So if you, yeah.
I have about 5 years experience in direct experience, along with also being a lead teacher before that. My education is in accounting, business management, and then I have about 4.5 years through UNI.
Hi, I'm here for the toddler room, and I have lots of experience being a nanny and babysitting growing up, and helping out with children's church and the nursery things at church, and then also being a paraeducator at the school in Fredericksburg for a little while. And I live here in Sumner with my husband and 3 kiddos, and just love kids.
I'm Alexis. I was previously a virtual assistant teacher, and now going to be the lead teacher in the infant room. I have experience with infants since I was 14 with babysitting, and then I also worked in a hospital in the maternity ward, so I worked with babies constantly there.
Thank you.
My name is Olivia, and I'm new to the community. I'm here from Denver,
area. I have 20 years experience in early childhood education. Prior to that, I worked in medical fields, both in patient care and in office staff. I have a background in early childhood through a certification, so I was a certified preschool teacher and administrator. Now they've kind of changed the rules on that, so it applies here, thankfully, I think still with Iowa, but and my background ranges from a family and child care provider in my home for many years. I worked in a day treatment program with children with special needs, and the last 7 years I was with one family as their nanny. And we're now residing here to be in a smaller community again and have better outreach to everyone here.
Thank you. You can just stand up if you'd like.
And I live here in Sumner with my husband and two children, and I just joined the board because I felt that I, as a parent, would never want to be in the situation of needing care, and we seen that was a very big issue in our community, and so I've been on the board ever since.
Thank you.
I am Stephanie Durkoff, and I am the board president, so I joined because I also know it's such an important thing in our community, and I want to make sure that our kids are getting the education that they have when they need to get into our school system, as well as provide more options within our community, not taking away from our in-home daycares, but providing more care for our families and making sure that our community is able to maintain as well as grow in the future. And I am a mom of four, under five, and then my husband also lives and works in our community as well as volunteers in the fire department.
I am Reed, also a board member of the secretary. I am blessed with own amazing in-home daycare, and I would like to offer the same experiences to other families that are needing care, knowing that your kid is safe and in great hands when you drop them off and pick them up there. Lifelong Sumner resident, as well as my husband, trying to give back to what shaped us.
Thank you, guys.
Are you guys all the teachers?
We have to be CPR certified. We take the 12-hour essentials, which covers anywhere from how to clean up a mess to sudden infant death, safe procedures that way, to car seat safeness. I mean, there's a whole bunch of different modules that the state makes us take. And then we also mandatory reporter universal precautions. I also, since we're on the CACFP, every staff member is going to be trained in how to do the infant care, so they know how to handle the breast milk and different stuff along the aspects of feeding, kids, cutting up the portions, that kind of stuff. So that way anybody that's in that room is going to be trained.
We'll do medication administration.
At least one person in the room has to have medication administration. And one person in the center has to have safe food, which I have both of those. And I think a couple of you guys were gonna take some of it too. So, yeah, lots of training.
And the good thing is if we ever, I know there's like questions of special needs and different things like that, there are so many trainings available. And I was explaining like to Ashley, I said, you can get on any training in any state, just about, if it's via Zoom and things like that. So there are, right now with the extreme need that every state is experiencing, it's not just Iowa, it's Colorado for sure, I can tell you that. So they're really making resources available to us. It's a great time actually to be a teacher and have that available.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you guys.
Thank you.